Oh, we okay. James, you're up.
Good morning. You have me again this week. You should learn, or I should have learned, don't volunteer yourself. I asked Jeremy, do you need any help this morning with the spaghetti thing? And he said, hey, can you do announcements? So I volunteered myself. Here I am. On that note, spaghetti after church. All right, the spaghetti lunch, fundraiser for the youth. I hear that the sauce is so good it actually takes years off your life. So that might be worth going to.
And that takes years off your life?
Or makes you younger, I should say. Yes, makes you younger. Yeah. Thank you for the correction. So it's healthy to eat. So it reduces your age. It takes aging off years at a time.
Oh, years off your age.
Yeah, I should have said that. Thank you, Roger.
I got you.
Yeah. Which leads us in, is a beautiful segue, thank you, Roger, into the next slide. Young at heart. Potluck this coming Thursday on the 11th at 11 a.m. Bring some food. And then be prepared for a time of singing and fellowship. Next slide, women on a mission. And there's kind of two parts of this slide, two slides that come together to equal the whole. Women on a mission will be meeting next Tuesday, the 16th at 10 a.m. in the East Wing. That seems to be our meeting place. All ladies 18 and up are welcome. And what are they looking for? They're doing some work on Operation Christmas Child. They'll be collecting notebooks and flip-flops. If you're from Hawaii, they're called slippas, but flip-flops is the common colloquial name. So notebooks and flip-flops, sizes 7 to 8, to bring for the shoe boxes. And there are donation boxes in the foyer. And finally, children's ministry training workshop. This is a great opportunity. We're trying to increase our ministry to young people, not just to our youth that Jeremy works with, from 9 a.m. to 2 p.m. in the East Wing, and lunch is provided. So please sign up for that. There's a couple ways to do it. You can see on the slide, and you can also go to the church app to sign up. But if we are looking for help in the children's ministry, so please, we need that help, but also come and learn how to help well so we can reach some of those that often are forgotten and harder to reach. And that is it. It's all you now, Roger. Oh, stand and greet one another. Thank you. Thank you.
Takes years off you.
you go ahead and please be seated.
Messiah still.
Go ahead and stand, please. And yes, just answer questions in your mind. I do think I'm getting better. At least I think I'm getting better until it hurts. And then I'm not so sure. But each day is a little better than the day before, I do believe. And I appreciate your prayers. Thank you very much. 2, 3. And... And when I am alone, oh, when I am alone, and when I am alone, give me Jesus. Give me And when I come to die, oh, when I come to die, and when I come to die, give me Jesus. Amen. Go ahead and please be seated. I'm going to invite Brother Bob to come on up here and do the scripture reading. I'm supposed to sing the solo this morning, but I'm sorry. I didn't get one prepared this week. So, Bob, come on up. We're going to dismiss the children right now to go to Children's Church, and you can follow Joy and Peter right down here. So, children, if you just come on down, and we appreciate that so very much. It is such a grand thing to see so many kids and involved in church, of all things.
Good morning. We'll be reading from the book of Galatians, chapter 6, verses 1 through 5. If you want to follow with your Bible, you're welcome to that. If you don't have a Bible and you would like to, there's a Bible in the pews that you're welcome to use. And if you don't have a Bible at home, you can take that home with you. If you would, and if you're able, please stand for reading of the Word. Brethren, even if anyone is caught in any trespass, you who are spiritual, restore such a one in spirit of gentleness, each one looking to yourself, so that you too will not be tempted. Bear one another's burdens, and thereby fulfill the law of Christ. For if anyone thinks he is something, when he is nothing, he deceives himself. But each one must examine his own work, and he will have reason for boasting in regard to himself alone, and not in regard to another. For each one will bear his own load. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we humbly come before you this morning, lifting up our praises and petitions, an act that is only possible through the work that was done on the cross. I ask you to listen to our praises and petitions, answer them according to your will and according to your time, dear Lord. I ask that the Holy Spirit be with us and guide us. Be with Pastor Jesse as he brings your word. May the words that he brings inspire us and help us to lead a life glorifying you. All these things I ask in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Bob. Good morning. We're back in Galatians. Hope you're excited about that. We are in the last chapter, if you can believe it. So here we go. We've got still probably about a month together in this wonderful book, considering what the Lord is teaching us about living in the grace of God. We are really to the practical portion of the book where Paul is helping the Galatians and now us think through what it looks like to be a people, to be a church, to be Christians who are living in light of this grace that is so critical and at the heart of our salvation. On Wednesday nights, we've been talking about church structure, which for some of you is exciting and for some of you is less exciting. We are moving on to thinking through the way the Lord has gifted each one of us this coming week, so I hope you'll consider joining us on Wednesday night for Bible study. But here we have a very practical case of what it looks like to be the body of Christ, what it looks like to be a church. And what we're going to see this morning is the balance, the critical balance that we must have between mutual commitment to one another in community and also not forgetting our individual responsibility before the Lord. We are supposed to be looking out for one another. That's part of what it means to be a church. And yet at the end of the day, we need to recognize that each one of us will give an account to the Lord. So Paul begins again throughout the letter. We see this sort of at key moments of transition within the letter. And it's an important reminder. Paul uses this word translated brethren or brothers and sisters. It's a family word. And we use it rightly in our church and in Christian context. And sometimes we lose sight of the meaning. We just say, you know, brother so-and-so, sister so-and-so. And if you have been in church for a while and that sounds normal to you, let me just remind you that that's weird to everybody else. When they hear you say that, they're like, why are you saying that that guy's your brother? He clearly isn't. That person is not your sister. Well, it's because we do this because it's good theology. It's biblical. We are family in the Lord. And if we are going to function the way that God has designed for us to function in one another's spiritual growth and development, we must never lose sight of the fact that we are indeed family. Whenever somebody joins our church, I get together with them and we talk about membership. For some people, especially if you grew up sort of in the Baptist world, going to Baptist churches, you just, you come to a new church and you go, yep, I like this place, need to join and become a member, and it's just kind of a habit. Other people who come and want to talk about membership, if they've not grown up in the Baptist church, oftentimes they go, this is kind of weird. I don't really know why I need to do this, but they're willing to talk about it. Well, one of the reasons why we do membership is because it's an important opportunity for us to affirm our commitment to one another. For that to be clear, and for that to not be wishy-washy, but for us to say, no, we are committed to one another. We are a family. I am a part of this local manifestation of God's church, and we are committed to one another. And this flies in the face of sort of the rugged individualism of America, which, by the way, is still more prominent here in Arizona. And I kind of like that as a guy coming from New England. Institutions are more accepted on the East Coast, but out here, you know, it's still the Wild West, kind of. I mean, we have Walmart and stuff, so not really anymore. But there's still a little bit of that individualistic attitude out here. And there's a lot of things that I really like about that. But it doesn't work for your faith. It doesn't work for your faith. There's an interesting man in church history, Simeon the Stylite. He is one of the first what are called the Desert Fathers in 423 AD. He decided he needed to just get away. So he went and lived on top of a 10-foot-tall pillar for 6 years. People would bring him food and goat's milk and stuff. And eventually he decided he needed to be further away from other people. So he got down off of that one And I'm not even sure what to imagine with this, but they built a 50-foot tall pillar for him to live on. And he stayed there for a total of 37 years, and he died up there all by himself. Now, that's an interesting story. I don't think that's a good example of what it means to be a Christian, though. Paul writes to brethren, plural, a community that is living together, that is walking after the Lord together, walking in step with the Spirit. It's been a couple of weeks, but chapter 5 was all about walking in the Spirit. Those commands to the community that they were to be walking in the Spirit. Paul says, look, family, here's something that probably will happen. Something that probably already had happened in Galatia. Maybe they hadn't responded well to it. He says, if anyone is caught in any trespass, caught like an animal caught in a trap in their sin. I want to just pause there before we even look at what Paul says as the response and just acknowledge and let sink in the fact that Paul expects this kind of a thing to happen. On Wednesday nights, as we've been studying the church, we look at Matthew 18, and there, we'll read it momentarily together, Jesus gives instructions for what to do when somebody sins and how to restore that person in a process. And that's actually deeply encouraging to me because our church, I don't know if you've noticed this yet, sort of spoiler alert, is actually not perfect. Just in case you didn't know, our church is made up of people who are trying to follow Jesus and are stumbling along the way and falling, and Jesus is not surprised by that. Paul, inspired by the Holy Spirit, is not surprised by that. That's good. That's good because it means that when we see these kinds of things, we don't need to despair and go, oh no, now what? We never planned for this. God never foresaw this happening. No, he knows that this kind of a thing happens. And so he says, when this sort of a thing happens, anyone's caught in any kind of trespass, notice how broad that is, you who are spiritual should restore such a one. Situation, somebody stuck in trespass, the goal is restoration. Who's supposed to make restoration happen? The ones who are spiritual. Okay, so is that like the elite sort of Navy SEAL team? You know, every church seems to have like SEAL Team 6 that goes out, you know, go help this guy. No, spiritual here is not a sort of class qualification within Christianity. Paul just talked about the Spirit in chapter 5. And guess who has the Spirit? Everybody who's a Christian. Everybody who's a Christian. This is where we're going. I'll just keep on promoting Wednesday night. No shame. I'd love to see you there. Wednesday night, we're going to be looking at 1 Corinthians. And we looked briefly at 1 Corinthians 12. Remember the first four verses? Paul begins this way. Now, concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I do not want you to be unaware. You know that when you were pagans, you were led astray. To the mute idols, however you were led. Lots of different ways to go wrong. Therefore, I make known to you that no one speaking by the Spirit of God says Jesus is accursed. And no one can say Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. So if you're a Christian, you've trusted in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. You can say Jesus is Lord. And Paul says you wouldn't do that if the Holy Spirit was not at work. So guess what? If you're a Christian, you're spiritual. We're not talking about like spiritual, like New Agey spiritual. We're just talking about the Holy Spirit is active in your life. So Paul says, you who are Christians, you are to restore that person. Restoring. The word is used in Matthew chapter 4, verse 21, as some of the disciples are mending their fishing nets. It's used for setting broken bones and mending them. That's the goal, restoration and healing. In Matthew 18, the goal is to win back your brother. Christians, we're supposed to love people. Supposed to love winning people. That's the word that's used in 1 Corinthians 9 about winning people to Christ. 1 Corinthians 9, 19 to 22. And winning back your brother who's broken by their sin. We love winning people, not arguments. So important. Don't lose sight of that. James is teaching a class on apologetics. And I appreciate some of the things that I've already heard him say about apologetics. The goal is not to win arguments, right? The goal isn't to win arguments. The goal is to win people. The goal is to share the gospel with those who don't know it, who don't understand it, who've misunderstood it. So restoration is the goal. And the way that we are supposed to achieve this goal is in a spirit of gentleness. You'll remember from chapter 5, verse 23, that gentleness is part of the fruit of the Spirit. We're supposed to exercise gentleness. There are wrong ways to try and restore people. Not being gentle is one way that we can go off track big time. My boys don't really like it when I dry their hair after they take a bath because I don't always remember to be gentle. I'm working on it. I always just think, okay, let's move this towel as fast as we can. Let's get the hair dry. And all of a sudden, you know, some tears are welling up. Sorry. Be gentle, right? Mom is so much better at those things, of course. Gentleness. We need to be intentional to be gentle. There are too many people out there. And sometimes this is just an excuse. And if it's just an excuse, that's on the person who's making up the excuses. But there are too many people who won't step foot in a church, won't step foot in our church, because they've been burned by people who claim the name of Christ who were not gentle when gentleness is what was required. And again, I'm not trying to throw our church under the bus. God is doing wonderful things here. But I know people who've told me, oh, you're the pastor at First Baptist. I couldn't go there. I said, why? Well, I went there one time and I had this kind of experience. And guys, that, again, maybe some of that's just excuses. And if it's excuses, it's on them. And we can't go back and we can't fix everything that's ever happened. But let that humble us. We need to be gentle with people. When we are restoring people, we see something that's not right in their lives. The attitude and the approach is one of gentleness. Not compromising on the truth. That's not loving, right? We don't compromise on what's true. And the expectation is that people who are caught in their sin would be repentant of their sin. But we do need to be gentle. There's some other wrong responses that are worth mentioning here. Sometimes when we see somebody trapped in sin, we just sort of go, wow, look at that. Sort of marvel, his ear was hurting. Doctor takes his little ear looking thing and looks in his ear. And he goes, whoa. And he calls some of the nurses and some of the doctors who are in training there. He says, look at this. Right? Everybody come, look at this. You want to know what an ear infection looks like? Like, here is a classic ear infection. And it was fine because, I mean, we want doctors to learn. We want them to see these sorts of things. Can you imagine if that's all that he did was just go, whoa, yep, that's a bad one. Look at how red that is. That would be terrible. We don't want to do that with people. When we see them stuck in sin, just go, oh, man, that's a bad one. You really messed up there. We can scoff at people when they are caught in their sin and the consequences of their sin. You know, have you ever been driving? Somebody is driving like a maniac, and then a little further down the road, you see him pulled over. And it makes you kind of happy, doesn't it? You're like, yep, hope you learn your lesson. But I hope and pray that you would not have that same response if you saw them crashed in a major accident, right? And we don't want that. When we see people in sin, we see them caught in their sin. and they're getting those consequences that are devastating. We don't just go, ha, good, got what you deserved. That's not gentleness. That's not the right attitude. We want to be restoring people with gentleness. So think about that. How do you respond when somebody's caught in sin? The right way to respond, and I do want to read this together. Let's go to Matthew 18. The right way to respond is laid out here. Matthew 18, the words of Jesus, verses 15 to 17. If a brother sins, go and show him his fault in private. A couple observations I want to make there. If a brother's caught in sin, we might have translated this, be going. It's a present tense imperative, which means that it has a continuous aspect. It's something that you should be doing on a regular and ongoing basis. It doesn't mean that you sort of go, oh, I mentioned it to him once, didn't see any change, time to go and see how much more public we can make this. No, you be regularly going to them. Now, what's the exact time to move to the next step? It really depends on the situation. Ask the Lord for wisdom. He promises to give it, according to James 1:5. But be going to this person, show them their fault, and do that in private. We don't turn people who are trapped in sin into a public spectacle. That's not the goal. That's not gentle. If he listens to you, you've won your brother. There's that winning language that I was talking about. But if he does not listen to you, then take one or two more, not everybody. Doesn't say start mentioning it, you know, in your prayer request time at Sunday school so you can talk about them. Just take one or two more with you so that by the mouth of two or three witnesses, every fact may be confirmed. All right, so still keeping this small. Then if he refuses to listen, then there's a place for church discipline. Church, we do need to be gentle. Our goal is restoration. But there is a place to also say if someone is persisting in sin and they don't want to change, that we need to acknowledge that by saying this person is in persistent rebellion, it does not line up with their profession of faith, and we do not recognize them anymore as a member of the community. They're to be treated like a Gentile and a tax collector. And that doesn't mean that we're now mean to this person. It means that we treat them as somebody who needs the gospel. Treat them as somebody who needs to be evangelized. That's the right response spelled out in some more detail. You can keep reading there the following verses as Jesus explains what that looks like. Paul encourages us in this process to be looking to ourselves, each one looking to yourself so that you will not be tempted. So important that we have a right understanding of ourselves. As we're dealing with other people. Remember Matthew chapter 7, verses 3 to 5, where Jesus says, hey, don't be focused on the speck in your brother's eye when you've got a log in your eye, right? Be self-aware. That's going to help you to be gentle, by the way, because that's going to humble you. Don't run into these sorts of situations thinking that you are the Messiah. You're not. Jesus is the Messiah. Jesus is the one who's going to save them. Jesus is the one who is perfect and without sin. Not any of us. Paul warns in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 12, about pride. And such an important little verse, I think. 1 Corinthians 10:12, therefore, let him who thinks he stands take heed that he does not fall. Right? Just Be careful. You think that you're the one who's upright and you've got everything all perfect and organized in your life? No, the qualification for going and talking to people is not that you have everything right in your life. It's that you are spiritual, that the Spirit is at work in you, and that you have an accurate estimation of yourself. That should be humbling. There are too many stories of people who have gone in supposedly to help someone and their pride has gotten in the way. Too many stories of pastors and other counselors who have supposedly been there to help someone, and that's turned into further sin through affairs and all kinds of awful things. You know that most affairs in ministry that start in this kind of a relationship have something to do with a relationship where the person counseling feels really needed and really important. And that feeds into this problem. There's a lack of humility there, and all of a sudden the person who needs help starts to trust that person instead of trusting in Jesus. So many things can go so very wrong when we don't have an accurate estimation of ourselves. C.S. Lewis wrote about pride, and he said, "Pride gets no pleasure out of having something, only out of having more of it than the next man. It is the comparison that makes you proud, the pleasure of being above the rest. Once the element of competition is gone, pride is gone." This is why we need the gospel. This is why the first few chapters of Galatians are so critical, because they crush our pride and remind us, remember, can you do anything to save yourself? No. Can you be a savior to yourself or to anybody else? No. Only Jesus can do that. Let that crush your pride. Have an accurate estimation of yourself. Some fear of God before his eyes, for he, I think would have been a little bit better translation here, for he flatters himself in his own eyes concerning the discovery of his iniquity and the hatred of it. So someone who is stuck, the ungodly, when they have transgression, they don't have any fear of God, and they just sort of flatter themselves and say, oh, everything's okay. Make sure that if you're going to help someone stuck in transgression that you don't have this attitude. So Paul says, look at yourself. Well, invite the Spirit to help you have a right estimation of yourself. Because we do want to be able to, verse 2, Galatians 6, bear one another's burdens. We need to help bear one another's burdens. This is why you can't go build a pillar in the desert and live by yourself and live biblical Christianity. So in case you were wanting to do that, not a good option, right? We need to be bearing one another's burdens. In case you're wondering about the answer to Cain's question, am I my brother's keeper? The answer is yes, you are. You are responsible for your brothers and sisters. You are supposed to be looking out for one another. We are supposed to be looking out for one another. Bearing one another's burdens is the exact opposite of what legalism does, right? Paul's been fighting against legalism, this idea that you can sort of load up rules and laws, and if you follow them, then you can please God. The Pharisees were known for that. Jesus addresses that issue in Matthew 23, verse 4. It's addressed in the sermons in Acts and Acts 15, 10, where the Pharisees are accused of creating laws that even they can't keep and just heaping up burdens on other people. That's not the gospel. That's not Christianity. Christianity says we look at our brothers and we bear one another's burdens. We reflect in a small way Christ, who bore our sins, right? That's what the gospel is. If you go to 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 24, such good news there. By the way, I'm sorry, a lot of these I did not get to Michelle, so if there's ever not verses on the screen, it's never Michelle's fault, it's always my fault, okay? Just so that you know. So you're gonna have to actually use your Bibles or your phones, wherever your Bible is, okay? This is talking about Jesus, 1 Peter 2:24, and he himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, so that we might die to sin and live to righteousness, for by his wounds we are healed. That's a reference back to Isaiah 53, which if you haven't read Isaiah 53 recently, go back and do that. A beautiful, beautiful prophecy about Christ who's going to come and bear the sins of his people. So when we bear one another's burdens, we don't bear one another's sins the way Jesus does. You can't do that. I can't do that. Praise God. Jesus did that for all of us on the cross. But we are pointing people to that, and we are living in a small way, a little microcosm of what Jesus did for us. I want to flip this text for a second. Paul here is saying you need to bear one another's burdens. But as we're thinking about pride, how do you feel when others try to help you bear your burdens? I don't know if any of you are fans of The Lord of the Rings. There's a scene where Samwise, he is like the epitome of a good friend, wants to help Frodo. And in the movies, it gets put into slow motion from Frodo's perspective. And Sam says, "Share the load." It's all slow like that. He's saying, "Frodo, I could help you carry the ring." And Frodo freaks out, right? Because the ring has affected his thinking, and he is prideful, he's anxious. He thinks that Sam would try and take it from him, and he can't accept help. You know, oftentimes, the reason why we can't ask for help or we can't accept help is our pride. See how pride creates so many problems in the Christian community? You should expect to help people, and you should expect to need help. Needs to flow both ways. Otherwise, if you think all I ever do is help people, nobody can help me, well, that's a pride problem. And you need to be careful with that, because that will lead you into all kinds of bad places. And pride is so hard to see in yourself, which is why Paul is encouraging us, look at yourself. Can you accept help? Can you help others? If you can't accept help, you're not ready to actually be helpful. Well, verse 3, "For anyone who thinks he is something when he is nothing deceives himself." Go to 1 John. 1 John chapter 1. We're going to look at verses 8 to 10. "If we say we have no sin, we are deceiving ourselves, and the truth is not in us." If you think that you have no sin, you're just deceiving yourself, not deceiving anybody else. "If we confess our sins, he is faithful and righteous to forgive us our sins, to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we've not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. But by the grace of God, we would be nothing." We have nothing that is untainted by sin in and of ourselves. We need God's grace. We need to be able to get an honest look at ourselves. Each one must examine his own work, looking at your life, not comparing yourself to other people, right? Then we will have reason to boast regarding himself alone and not in regard to one another. You know that God has called each one of us and gifted each one of us in different ways. So you don't need to look at me and go, "Well, I'm not preaching a sermon every Sunday, so I'm not sure that I'm everything God wants me to be." Well, if God didn't call you to be a pastor, you don't need to preach a sermon every Sunday, right? God has called you to do whatever it is that he's called you to do. I'm not sure exactly what that is, but what God is looking for is that we would be faithful with the things that he has given to us. Romans chapter 12 has given each of us a measure of faith. He's given each of us these different gifts and talents and abilities, and we are called to use them. Martin Luther wrote, "A faithful sexton is no less pleasing to God with his gift than a preacher of the word, for he serves God in the same faith and spirit." Don't compare yourself to other people. Compare yourself to who God is called you to be. Use the standard of God's words in your self-evaluation, because, verse 5, each one will bear his own load. And you might read that and you say, "Wait a minute. We just talked about bearing one another's burdens, and now you're saying each one is going to bear his own load." Well, two different words in Greek, and it's significant. The first one is a burden, and it refers to the kind of like loading up cargo that would get loaded up onto a ship. Here, the word load in verse 5 refers to like your backpack, your personal belongings, your personal responsibilities. When we traveled last summer, trying to teach this sort of a thing to my kids, we bought little tiny suitcases for the boys with wheels. It was cute, sort of. Actually, it was hard. trying to get through the airport, right? We wanted them to say, like, hey, like, this is your stuff. You're responsible. And those little ones, actually, they didn't have anything too valuable. A few toys, trucks, granola bars, things like that. But, right, it's the idea of, like, you need to be responsible for your things. And that is true. As a community, we do need to look out for one another. We do need to help carry one another's burdens. And yet we also have individual responsibilities. One person commenting on this gave an illustration and said, if my car breaks down, my neighbor can help drive my children to school. But he cannot or should not assume the responsibilities that belong to me as a father. That's the difference. It's wrong for me to expect someone to be a father in our family. We need to help each other with unexpected needs and problems as they come up. But we also have God-given callings. If you're the dad at home, you need to be the dad. That's your backpack. That's your suitcase. You need to carry that. Nobody else can do that for you. So we need to be able to distinguish these things. Brothers and sisters, we will give an account to the Lord. It's important that we not lose sight of that. Romans chapter 14, I'm going to start in verse 10. The Apostle Paul writes this, "But you, why do you judge your brother? Or again, why do you regard your brother with contempt?" Shouldn't be looking at each other for that sort of thing. We need to look at ourselves. "For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee will bow to me and every tongue will give praise to the Lord. So each one of us will give an account of who? Of himself to God." I don't know if you remember in the book of Ezekiel, chapter 3, Ezekiel is being commissioned by God. And he is a prophet. It's like a watchman who's supposed to be announcing if there is a problem approaching the city. And God says, if you don't do your job, and you don't tell the people that there is danger coming, then the blood of the people who die is on your hands, Ezekiel. That's your job. But he says, if you do announce it, and they don't listen, and they don't care, well, that's on them. Right? We have a responsibility, a personal responsibility, that we need to not lose sight of. And yet, we also, part of that responsibility is to do our part to support one another and to be a healthy community, bearing one another's burdens, helping one another when we are stuck in our trespass, when we have fallen into sin, gently calling one another out of that back into life and healthiness before the Lord. I just want you to remember these things that we're called to do point us to Jesus. They point us to what God has done for us. We are supposed to represent Christ to one another. Did Jesus leave us stuck in our sin? Praise God, he didn't, right? Jesus came to seek and save the lost. So we want to be Christ-like in our interactions with one another. This morning, if you hear that last little bit, Jesus came to seek and save the lost, and you go, I'm lost. I'd love to talk with you about Jesus Christ, what he's done for you, for me, and dying on the cross to save us from our sins. And if you're stuck this morning and you sort of recognize that, you want somebody to talk to pray with, I'd love to pray with you. You can come catch me after the service. Give us a call this week. Brothers and sisters, let's seek to be the kind of church that God has designed us to be, that we might all stand before the Lord, not with pride in our hearts, but with great gratitude, able to show the Lord lives that have been changed by his grace and his mercy. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you that you have been gentle with us and you have not left us stuck in our sins. I pray that we would care well for one another. I pray that we would seek one another out, not for the purpose of embarrassing anyone, not for the purpose of inflating our pride, but simply out of love in a spirit of gentleness would be a church that calls one another to continue onward in holiness, that we might all stand before you unashamed of the lives that we have lived that have been changed by your Spirit and your grace. Work in our church to this end, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's stand together.
Oh, how he loves you.
If you filled out one of those connection cards and want to give it to us, just put it in the offering basket that's down here in the front or the boxes as you leave the sanctuary that are beside each of the doors. And if you have an offering to give, that's you can put it in the same place. Is there any other word, Jesse, other than why don't you just kind of ask the blessing for us as we're getting ready for those of us who are going over here to chow down?
Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to have gathered and worshiped your name, and I pray that you would continue to be honored as we enjoy a meal together. Use the food to nourish our bodies. May our time of fellowship serve for the purpose of building one another up and getting to know one another and showing your love through the way that we interact. I pray that this would benefit the youth and their endeavors to get out to camp, and I pray that they would be safe and enjoy this time of service as well. In Jesus' name, amen.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord.
You're dismissed.